Hello and welcome to the latest edition of the SWN podcast. I'm your host, as always, Billy. Hopefully, with a decent voice, because the last thing I recorded was some sort of Discovery Wrestling preview where I seem to have my balls and no longer dropped. They went back into my body because I had a cold. I am joined on this edition for something a little bit different, because I've no idea what we're going to really get into other than possibly a match card somewhere in the long line. It is Andrew Crammond from Bleeding Gums Wrestling. They've got a show coming up.
Thanks
Welcome
for
to the
having me.
show.
Yeah, thank you. It's a pleasure to be here. Thanks for asking me to be on. So yeah, we'll talk about death matches and get into all that.
I know, and if anyone's listened to anything that I've done in the past, they'll know that I'm not really a death match boy. I'm basically, give me a story, a big laughy story of silly characters with no blood. I'm all in kind of thing. So this is gonna be an education for me. As well as an education, hopefully, for people that are listening. So,
Yeah.
before we get into your backstory, we'll just plug the show just in case people listen to this and go, I don't want to hear Billy cringe his way through a podcast about stuff he doesn't know about. So, we've got the Ultra Violence Referendum on the 18th of November 2023, taking place at the Section Room in Summerhall, Edinburgh. There is
Yep.
a big match card of death matches, and not just death matches, there is also other stuff on the show, a variety of show. So just for the quick sell, where'd you get tickets? And then we'll move on to finding out a bit more about yourself.
So I could the best thing for anybody that wants to get anything to do with Bleeding Gums, socials, tickets, merchandise, anything. We've got a website, www.bleedinggumswrestling.co.uk, that has links to everything. I'll have all the tickets there. We've got GA tickets, we've got VIP tickets for 35 quid, GA's 25. We've also got student discounts as well for because it's in a massive student area, which I think will be pretty good. That's actually worked quite well. But VIP, basically, we've got a few of them left. You come in, you get a seat, which is amazing. But getting a seat, a poster, you're in early, and you get pictures with all the guys. Because it's a lot of the guys' first time ever sort of being here. So yeah, the best time for get tickets or anything to do with us is bleedinggumswrestling.co.uk.
Perfect. That's fine. So there's the first plug of the recording. We'll go on to find out more about yourself, though. So this is your first event. Is this your first promoted event that you're doing? Just in general, not just under the Bleeding Gums banner.
In general, it'll be the first time I've been running anything. The last since COVID, I've been down south. Maybe like sometimes two, three times in a month to go and see how wrestling, usually with TNT, Kumite, or Rise down south in like Leeds and Hull and Liverpool. But through meeting people like that, I've been working backstage, mainly on the weapons building side of things, taping up light tubes and putting barbed wire to doors and things like that. So I've been doing that for like a long time and made a lot of connections with people like Big Joe, Michael Caden and stuff like that, and I was just basically like, you know what, I'll do it up here. Why not? I've got the connections. I think it would sell quite well, which it's been going quite well so far. But there's nothing like that here, so I just thought, fuck it, I'll give it a go. And if it's a dismal failure, then it's on me. But I wanted to at least try it, because I've got a fair sort of. It's my first promoted show myself, but I've helped out a lot with backstage stuff and setting up things and everything, so just give it a go on my own, pretty much.
Yeah, I mean, and ICW have no longer that kind of product, but that's probably the last kind of time you would have had a more extreme version of wrestling regularly
Yeah.
in Scotland,
Yeah.
and that was what, a good 2 3 years ago that since they've moved away from that kind of branding.
I think that ICW is obviously, they've done death matches and they've done King of Insanity and everything here. But I think that's not been their MO, even when they have had them. They've not been like, we are purposefully doing. They've had over 18s content, but it's not been over 18s deathmatch stuff. Like, they wouldn't promote themselves as that. So I think that this is the first time there's ever been anything like this in Scotland, aside from obviously King of Insanity and stuff like that. But there's never been a full show. Aside from there was like a tournament many, many moons ago in ICW, but that wasn't technically a death match tournament. That was like, you know, a kendo stick match. Like, they weren't like, you know, light tubes, and there was stuff in that, but there's not been anything like this, I'd say.
So let's go back to the start then for yourself. So how did you get into wrestling? What was the moment that you watched and thought, you know, I like this, I'm going to keep watching it?
Oh God. I spoke this on another podcast. The first ever match I ever saw, this is, I don't ask me why it was this. It was on VHS. My dad tape traded with a guy who lived across the street. And it was Rey Mysterio and 9-1-1 versus the Eliminators in ECW in 1986. That was the first ever match I ever saw, and I just got hooked. And then I obviously watched ECW from a very, very young age, probably too young to be watching ECW. But then it was into like WWF 1988, when it was wrestling was the biggest thing in the world. It seemed to be when you were a kid. And I was just hooked. I was hooked from buying all the figures, watching all the shows when I could watch them. My dad let me stay up to watch Raw, like live before school and everything. Yeah, I was hooked. But it was, 1996 was the first time I ever saw anything.
Nothing makes more sense than you doing a deathmatch show when your first exposure to wrestling is ECW. Even though it's Rey Mysterio, so it'd probably be a bit more Lucha stuff and all that, but you've got 9-1-1 who would just throw people into things. And Eliminators, much same.
But like I'd seen obviously the figures, like I had like the wrestling figures and I'd seen them and I was always curious as to what it was. But like my mum was quite strict and was like, no, we're not watching any of that sort of crap in the house. But then my dad's got me introduced to it. But ECW.
So it's his fault. So from there then, do you remember what your first action figure was?
I've still got them. They're not in box. I've got some stuff in box. I would think, fucking hell, it was like it would have been the last one I can remember. It was like a really, really crappy Vince McMahon, but he's wearing like a vest and black. I think it was this match they had against Austin.
Oh, was it the one where it's like bone crunching at the top and then it's like hard plastic for the legs?
Yeah. I don't know if that was the exact first figure, but that's the oldest one I've got that like I actually bought when it was like brand new. Yeah.
I remember them. There was like autograph series ones and it was like that. And it had Vince McMahon's autograph on the leg.
Terrible. You couldn't do anything with them. You couldn't like actually do any moves with them, but like they were awful. But yeah, I had like a signature on the front. Yeah.
There we go. I remember that. All right. Okay. All right. We'll move on. But I remember that series because there was a Triple H one. My friend had a Triple H one. I had the Vince McMahon, but I used it as Shane McMahon because by that point I had the Titantron, so I had a gray suit, which kind of what he looks like now, but with a mustache drawn on.
I think I actually like him. I think he looks cool with his mustache. I think it makes him look like more evil and sinister than like I think he wants to himself. I think I quite like it. It's like Dick Dastardly or something from the fucking Wacky Races.
It's like he's moved into going, oh, everyone thinks I'm a villain. I'm going to look like a villain now. That's just, why not?
I like it.
My first one was Draws.
My first one was
kind of the same series because it started the bone crunching stuff, but everything could bone crunch from the legs down and all that kind of stuff. So, yeah, that, Shamrock and Goldust, I got the same holiday. First figures.
I mean, I've still got like all the, they're still in my mum's attic in a big black bag, but I've got, because of me like in ECW and then when all these guys came to the WWF, like I've got like the Just Incredible and Stevie Richards, like Right to Censor. Like who would actually buy that? But like I was like, oh, I like Stevie Richards. But like I always got these figures like of random people. So I don't know. Maybe some of them are worth money, but they're all out of box anyway.
That's it. Well, nowadays I'm 33 and I should be a grown up. He says with a bunch of toys in the background. To those in the audio listeners, is Funko Pops. Just in case you think it's anything weird. But yeah, even now I'm looking on Smiths and go, oh, there's a Noam Dar, it's £5. Oh, kind of want it. Because, you know, I do a Scotch podcast, I should get a Noam Dar if I can.
Yeah.
You know, and all that kind of stuff. So I don't think you ever grow out of that. If you like action figures growing up,
I can't remember who described it to me, but it was somebody said, like, everybody's got their own stupid thing. Mm-hmm. Doesn't matter what it is, whether it's figures or football or wrestling or whatever. Everybody's got their own stupid things. So if it makes somebody like happy to do it, then fuck it, why not? You know what I mean?
Yeah. I mean, my always thought is as long as it's not drugs.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, that's a very good point. Yeah.
It could be worse. If a mother-in-law or something goes, oh, you've got lots of toys and kids' toys, like, but at least it's not drugs. So let's just move on. it's always safer. So from that point then, ECW into Attitude Era. Did you ever have a drop off, or were you always finding something to keep your wrestling investment?
I mean, when all my friends dropped out of wrestling, I'm the same age as you, I'm 33. So all my friends dropped out of wrestling when wrestling wasn't popular anymore, around about the invasion. I kept watching. A lot of my friends now who are lapsed fans that have now got back into, like my best mate Larry, he's now, he watches Raw every week, he watches AEW. Me and him went to, were you All In as well?
I wasn't. No, I don't watch AEW. No.
He forced me to go to All In. I didn't want to go. It was the seats were terrible, by the way. But for me, from then, I was like 2005, 2006 and stuff. I was like the only person I knew that was watching wrestling. This was back when like fucking the Highlanders and the Heartthrobs and that were wrestling on Heat. And I was like, I've never stopped. I've dropped out of WWEF, say like 2009, 2010. And then that's when I got straight into all the indie. I'd still watch indie stuff. But like this is when deathmatch wrestling sort of consumed my life from when I got to like about 17 or 18.
Right, we'll definitely get into that.
A beer, by the way. It's a San Pellegrino if anybody thinks I'm drinking a beer.
Well, this will come out after five, so it's all good. We won't be judged upon. But yeah, that's, I was the same. Yeah, I still watched. We've had Rory McAllister on the podcast in the past, which I was so excited. Like, everyone, I thought, oh, this is going to be the one that's going to blow up and everything. Did okay, but I was like, that's amazing. I got Rory McAllister. I got one of the Spirit Squad because I love that kind of
period. Back and listened to the Spirit Squad one, but I'm not listening to Rory McAllister. I need to listen to that.
Yeah, but I'm endeavouring. I want to get Robbie. I've messaged him a couple of times. I'm getting Robbie McAllister at some point. I need him. I need him to complete my set.
Do they still wrestle?
Yeah, he still wrestles in Canada.
All right, okay, fair enough.
If you wanted to do if this show goes well and you want to do a second one, Rory still wanted to do one final tour of Scotland. So you know.
Oh God! I mean that. I'm just trying to think who would have him wrestle. Oh God!
Everyone.
Everybody gets McAllister. Who was gets... turned up in TNA?
That was Robbie.
That was.
I did bring it up in the podcast, but that's also why I want Robbie. Even though he's probably mentioned it a million times. Anyway, this isn't a podcast. That's about you. So, how did you get into deathmatch wrestling then? So we know you liked ECW growing up, actually. So that there always was going to be a foundation of the more extreme side to wrestling. But how did you find out deathmatch?
The guy stayed across the street with tape trade. My dad would give him weird shit, like random CDs, and like he had like a kid that wanted like CDs. My dad would get him stuff from America. So, but anyway, he gave my dad a VHS tape, and it was the best of CZW and the best of IWA Mid South from 1999 and 2001, and 2001. And the first match I ever saw was a House of Horrors death match with Corporal Robinson against Mean Mitch Page. Light tubes hanging from the ceiling, and I was fucking blown away. I was like, what is this? How is this legal? These are lights. This is glass. And it was in a building of like 18 people. I was like, I love this. And from that VHS tape that I've still got, I just felt this would have been, I would have been 12. And from then I was like, this is different. There's nothing like it. And I just fell in love with it. And CZW and IWA Mid-South from that point on, I mean, both of them now, IWA is dead, but CZW's not the same. They've got Tournament of Death this coming Saturday. But yeah, I've never stopped. I love the violence, and I love the sort of underground cult nature of it, where a lot of people hate it, and I quite like that.
So are you always into like horror and gore and stuff like that?
Yeah,
so is that just because when you're saying you're 12 and you're watching this and loving it, so I'm assuming there's a little bit of a B-movie gore kind of film that you like.
My dad, it's my dad's fault. I'll blame my dad for all of this. My dad was showed me like The Shining and The Exorcist and It and things like that when I was like 10. So like I'd always kind of had like a warped sense for watching. Like I still love horror movies now. But yeah, when I was younger and then I got into all this stuff, probably a lot younger than most people should feasibly get into them. But yeah, it changed my life, to be honest, watching deathmatch wrestling. And it's something that I've never stopped watching.
And was it anything live? When was your first kind of live experience? Was that years later? Of course, you would have had to be over 18, of course.
Yeah, exactly.
There's a good period between you been watching it and going to see it.
I think the first live actual show I went to, because at this point I didn't know there was deathmatch wrestling in the UK, until I saw Big Joe at Tournament of Death. The first live deathmatch show I went to is I flew to Atlantic City to go and see GCW's Tournament of Survival 4. But before then, it would just been watching it, because I didn't know you could have stuff in the UK. Like Rise and TNT, who were still running death matches at that point, they were still sort of in their infancy of doing that for DOA and things like that. But I didn't know, I was like, there's nothing in the UK, so I need to travel for it. So that was 2018. but I'd been watching stuff religiously, live pay-per-views and everything since before then.
Mm-hmm. Was there any guys that initially took notice of in your first? Okay, yeah, I've heard of him.
Nick Gage is my favorite wrestler of all time. Seeing him in AEW against Chris Jericho on live TV with light tubes and everything was a tear at my eyes, so it did. But yeah, Nick Gage was a sort of introduction to me. There's a lot of guys who were doing it, like Zandig and things like that at the time, who have now since retired or they've moved on from wrestling or they've died. Not because of wrestling injuries, but because of, like a lot of wrestlers back from those days, a lot of it's to do with drugs. Mm-hmm. And things like that. A lot of people have died far too soon in wrestling. It's been the same case in deathmatch wrestling as well. But yeah, Nick Gage was certainly somebody who I still love.
There's some, like, I've heard of Zandig. Zandig is mainly because of the Botchamania meme. Yeah, that's how I've heard of Zandig. I knew of CCW because it was on Wrestling Channel for a little bit.
Yeah, yeah.
As well. So it's all stuff I've kind of heard of, but not really taken into because it's not something that I've particularly went, I need to see people bleed. It's not my kind of thing. it's just fine. Absolutely fine.
It's not for everybody. Zandig, there's Zandig's Tournament of Death, which is arguably probably one of the bigger tournaments in the world for deathmatch wrestling. Mm-hmm. The most famous thing he probably ever did was he did a mother effing bomb, which is a sort of gorilla press slam to sick Nick Mondo off a 25-foot roof through a light tube log cabin and all these tables outside. It's probably like, he did one with Joey Janela recently as well, where they jump off a roof into the back of a car with boards on fire and everything. So yeah, Zandig's a sort of living legend. He still does appearances occasionally, but yeah, it wasn't the Wrestling Channel. I'm surprised when you watched that. There was like a bloody hour or something that was on quite late on the Wrestling Channel, and it was like
after 10 or something, 10 or 11. Yeah,
I used to love the Wrestling Channel, and then it just kind of died, and I was quite upset.
Oh, I loved it I got to see TNA. I love DNA, and you got to, and I got to see things like Turning Point 2004, Elix Skippers, Cage Walk. And I think I still have it on tape somewhere. I have it on DVD as well somewhere. But yeah, it's in a personal collection.
I was really into watching like Japanese, like All Japan Women's Wrestling when the Wrestling Channel was on. My dad would watch that, and it was like the best thing ever because they would like beat the shite at each other. And watching, you got like Noah was on the Wrestling Channel, you got FWA, 1PW, who are now dead once again. They were on the Wrestling Channel, but yeah, Wrestling Channel was a big thing, and they even showed Cage of Death 7 live on the Wrestling Channel for CZW, which was amazing at the time. I remember that, and like, it might be like the day after or something, but I think it was like relatively soon. I was like, holy shit, I can actually watch a CZW thing and not have to like buy a tape or buy a DVD and have to wait like 4 weeks for it to arrive. But yeah, the Wrestling Channel is great.
I know, I love it. I don't think, I mean, now with the age of streaming, you can just go onto YouTube and watch anything you want. But I think it was so cool for finding out more about other wrestling. And like you said, that's how I got into TNA, and it was well worth it, for especially seeing their 1000 show coming up and seeing Shark Boy and all that kind of thing. Love it.
Are you going to the Glasgow one?
Unfortunately, I'm not. But this will go out just beforehand. We will have someone on site to do hopefully some reviews and
I'm potentially gonna go. But like the only thing that was like, I was like, ugh, I don't really want to go. Like I wasn't that interested. And then I was like, oh, Rhino. I was like, Rhino's there. I was like, I'm buying a ticket. I'm gonna go and see Rhino. That's fine. But it looks mental. But then the one that's the day after is the pay per view. I think.
And Newcastle, isn't it? Turning Point with Will.
Yeah, Turning Point is the pay per view in Newcastle. So yeah, but the Glasgow one's, where is it? It's at the O2 Academy, I think.
Yeah. But I was looking at it, and you know, I've got 1 year old, so money is tight as it is. So I've got to pick and choose where I go now. So it's I thought, no, I've got a WrestleZone like the week after, and then I've got a W3L the day after that. So I'm like, oh, that's my two shows for the October. Don't think I can get away with taking a jolly down to Glasgow as well.
No, I totally agree. I mean, to be fair, I've still not actually bought a ticket for it yet. So by the time I actually get around to it, it might have like actually sold out. But I'd quite like to go just to see Rhino. But it's kind of cool that they're doing this little mini tour. But I think obviously a lot of this, it's probably planned in advance, but a lot of this is British wrestling's massive now.
Mm-hmm.
At the minute, having AEW in Wembley and WWE doing Money in the Bank and John Cena coming out and saying they're wanting to do Mania here and stuff like that. Like, yeah, British wrestling's huge just now.
It's a boom again, but different kind of boom, because back in what, 2014, 15, when like ICW had its proper big explosion, they had the Fight Club documentary and stuff like that. That was like a good boom period for maybe indie fans. They got to see all these new people, but now it's a different boom where all the Americans and all the US companies would come over and go, I want a piece of this pie as well. So you got like, you got your GCW.
Bleed them dry, yeah.
Yeah, exactly.
Bleed them dry with all the money. Like when we were sitting at All In, they announced it for next year, and I just went, oh, I was like, we're going to have to go. Like, it's more money. Like, I don't know.
I'm in the same boat. I'm like, I don't watch AEW. It's just wherever it is, when I watch the product, it just feels like it's I don't know how to describe it, but like sarcastic. And it just feels like it's just a constant going, oh, look what we're doing, kind of thing, going, just get on with it.
It's,
come on.
It's very like insidery,
breaking
the fourth wall. There is some fantastic wrestling on it, and you do get but I mean they just fucking got Edge.
Yes.
Last week. So I was like, oh, that's pretty cool. But then I don't know, it's even that isn't enough to make me watch the product. For WWE and AEW, I'm going completely off topic here, but WWE and AEW, I only watch them if I'm at them live or if I'm at my mate's house. I'm like, if say there's like the Rumbles on or Survivor Series, we all go to a friend's house and we all have a drink and we all watch it. That's when I watch it. I don't watch it every week because there's so much fucking indie wrestling to watch that I don't see the point. Like,
to be honest, I can probably watch anything I need to watch through a 2-minute video on Twitter when I scroll through it. I used to watch all the pay-per-views live, all the WWE ones anyway, but just after this, my wee bundle of joy arrived, I can't stay up to watch them. And if I don't watch it live, I'm not going to find time to watch it, because between do my actual real what pays me job doing this and trying to spend quality time and all that kind of stuff, I don't have any minutes to spare to sit down for 3-4 hours to watch wrestling. That's just
exactly it's on every night, literally pretty much every night, and you're like, I can't find time to do this. But it's the sort of thing where even GCW, who are huge now, they've got a show on like 8 days a week, and I'm like, who has time to watch this? Which is where I quite like, going back to like CZW and IW Mid-South, they would run one show a month. And I think that's a sweet spot for an independent company and for fans. I think that one show a month or one show every couple of months is like perfect, because like there's, like you're saying, if you've got kids and you've got a full-time job and you've got various other, like, you don't have time to watch all this wrestling.
Yeah. I mean, for me, at least it's one ticket. I'm going over to Aberdeen or wherever. But if you've got kids, like I said, that's what, £40 minimum to go to a show. And then they'll want to, obviously, they'll want food or they'll want merch while they're there. They'll want to hang about. There's got to be a raffle, of course. Is there going to be a raffle at Ultraviolet?
I was going to, I might do, because I've actually got things to raffle now, but I was purposely going to get the ring announcer. I'll just drop this on a spoiler. The ring announcer is Santiago, who is a guy from down south who used to announce Rise. He's not done ring announcing for about 3 years now, but he's doing us a favour and he's coming up doing the show, so that'll be cool. But I was going to get Santiago to announce that there is not a raffle, just to make myself laugh, but there actually probably is going to be a raffle now.
But it has to be a raffle, and then the snacks and all that kind of stuff. And they'll want to stay behind to see the wrestlers, so you've got to stand in the queue for that. And it's a long day, I assume. I haven't had to go through it yet, but it's a long day, to an expensive. If there's running shows like you're saying, 8 days a week, and all that kind of stuff. Jesus, how? There's a cost of living crisis.
That's what I don't understand. You see a lot of these people. I mean, it's more so like WWE shows and that. But you see a lot of the guys, and you're like, how the fuck are you at all these shows? What do you do for a living that you manage to travel around the country and go to all these shows? But I don't know.
Which building did you fall off by accident?
There has to be a bit of that. There has to be some sort of scam or money laundering scheme that's going on that they've managed to get to all these shows. But good for them.
Oh yeah, I mean, if you want to go to every show wearing the same T-shirt so you can get recognised at shows, I mean, go for it. You know, it's your money.
Exactly.
and you can't judge people want to do that. Right, so we got off topic, and I've go back to podcasting. That's how we'll slam back into it.
Yeah.
So before ultraviolence referendum was a thing, you took up a little bit of podcasting. You did at first. I was having a wee scroll through. It was more gameplays, and you did a little bit of post show react during show reaction stuff like that. What kind of made you pursue that? Was that just a way to be in the business, but not in the business? What was your kind of thought?
COVID, that was, and people are going to hate me for saying this. COVID was one of the best times in recorded history for me because I was being paid 100% of my wages to sit in my house, and my best friend stays across the street, and we were getting hammered every single day. And I was being paid full money. And eventually, once you get so bored of that, I was like, right, what can I do? Because it was a sort of point where it made me want to be creative, I suppose. And I started doing those reaction things, and then I started doing music video things where I'd put wrestling, GCW, and deathmatch stuff with like music that I liked. Because a lot of the times, if you watch these little music highlight videos, the music in them is fucking terrible. It's all like death metal, like screamo, like stuff. Not for me, not for me. And then I did that, and some of them were getting like 20,000 views, 15,000 views, and everything. I was like, oh, all right. But then now I've looked back on it. You can't make any money off of that because it's all copyrighted because of the music. And I was like, oh, people seem to like these. And I was like, ah, right. It's just because it's free. That's why people are watching them. But then from then, I was like, I like deathmatch wrestling. I'll do like a deathmatch weekly roundup thing or every couple of weeks. And then that just sort of took a life of its own, and that done quite well. And I've done 50 episodes of that. And yeah, it just COVID sort of made me think, fuck it, I want to try and get involved in wrestling. And that's before then was when I started going to like Rise and TNT and Kumite and stuff. And just wanting to be involved in wrestling. I've never ever wanted to wrestle, but I've always wanted to be involved in behind the scenes to do with wrestling. So I mean, I've sort of forced my hand now to run my own thing up here. But yeah, it was COVID. So I think COVID was excellent for people. It was obviously shit for a lot of people.
Oh yeah.
But it was terrible for a lot of people. But I mean, for me, creatively, it was like probably one of the best things that's happened.
See, I think we're both sides or two sides of the same coin here, because I was the same. Yeah, after I had my niche, which is Scottish wrestling, your niche is deathmatch wrestling. And yeah, the pandemic came around, and for me it was, I don't have any shows to write about or do. So you know what? Who's free? I'll see if I can get someone to speak to me. And that was it. And I think we're barreling towards with things like on location bits and stuff like that, 250 episodes. So it's absolutely insane. And I know, I mean, I'm not making money from it. Odd bit of Patreon cash, but it's just, it keeps you sane, doesn't it? This kind of thing where you get to be
You
that
do it.
creative
You do
and
it
do
because
that.
you love it. You do it because you love it, man. And that's amazing, 250, like nearly 250 episodes. I just stopped doing it because I was far too busy. And it would get to the point where I'd do one once a month. And then I'd have to sit there with a pen and paper and watch 14 shows in a row. And I was like, right. I was like, this isn't fun.
Yeah, it becomes a job.
I'd leave it so long that I was like, right, I've got so much to catch up with. And there'd be like tournaments and shows in Japan, and I'd cover Japan and Mexico and everything. And then I would get to it and I was like, it used to be about like half an hour long. And I was like, all right. But then it got to the point where like some episodes were like an hour and 45 minutes. And it was just me sitting talking. Like, I'm hopefully wanting to do something soon with one of my mates where we're going to do a similar thing on Spotify or whatever, but it's going to be two of us. So it's not just me shouting for like where there's somebody to like actually respond back to, because like just shouting yourself is a thankless task. Even if people like it for yourself, like 14 shows in the space of like 2 days to sit and watch them, it's agonizing.
No, eventually by show 12, you're going, so and so has beaten so and so. So and so did this. And yeah, I do a couple solo stuff, but I try to make sure, or with agreements from promotions, to put splice in their video footage. So it means it breaks up me speaking. At least it breaks up the sound, and they can have a promo put in there and all that kind of stuff. So it's, but
It's a better
no,
idea.
yeah, podcasting is not, it's fun in the respect of you get to do something creative. But yeah, that side of things where you look at, listen back, or well, I don't listen to my own voice, but I listen back to it and go, Christ, you've spoken for 45 minutes here and you've said nothing. This is boring. But
Yeah.
people, and then people come up to you and go, oh, that was a great show you did there. That was amazing when you spoke about this. I'm like, was it? Because I bored myself to tears there for a moment.
That was the same thing. Like, people would message me, they're like, when's the next one coming out? When's the next one coming out? And I'm like, suppose I'll do it next week. And then you've got to find time to set aside and do it. Then you've got to edit it, because I would edit it with all the graphics and like little promos and video things on the side. And it was fine, but it was just like, that would be recording it and doing all that. That's like a full day. And like, I'd be sitting on the PC and my missus would be like, she's like, why is this? T-? I was like, because it takes time to find all the graphics and do everything. But hopefully I'll get back to doing it with my mate and do it on Spotify, which I think would be easier, because then it's just, you don't even have to see anything. Which is how I usually listen to podcasts now, is just listening to it on my way to work, as opposed to actually sitting watching it.
That makes all sense in the world. And when you watch this particular episode on YouTube, you'll see that we have none of that. We've got intro, outro, this bit in the middle. That is all I'm doing, because I use a laptop that's about 20 years old and Windows Movie Maker, which is probably older than that. So I am not editing any more than I have to on
Fair
an episode.
enough. Fair enough.
Because that's it. People like Spotify and listen to an Apple podcasts, and you do all that effort, like you're doing finding all the graphics and that, and the people are just going to listen to it in their
What's supposed
ears and not
to
watch it. Yeah, it'd be like, why did I bother stressing myself looking for a specific, particular graphic? So yeah, you stay in 14 shows. So deathmatch wrestling has kind of exploded again, because it was quite a big thing back in way back when, Terry Funk, Cactus Jack, all that kind of stuff, and it's kind of exploded again. And for me, as an outsider who's not in that kind of bubble at all, it kind of exploded again when Matt Cardona started visiting GCW.
Yeah, I love
So,
Matt. Oh, I'm just so sorry to interrupt you there, but
all
like,
right.
when he was in WWE, I fucking hated Zack Ryder. I just thought, I was like, I don't get it. I don't find him entertaining. I don't find him funny. I think he's boring. But then when he came on the Indies, he had probably one of the best death matches of the year against Nick Gage and won the belt. And the crowd was pelting the ring with bottles and cans, and the hatred for him, it was excellent. I love Matt Cardona now. Yes, I think a lot of it was to do with COVID as well, because all the shows obviously had to have the, what are they called, social distancing. But GCW and IW, sorry, ICW and Old Bard were running just in like fields and like in barns and outside, and no one else was running shows apart from like the Thunderdome and where did AEW run it? Daly's place.
Daily's place, yeah.
But like, apart from that, like GCW and ICW and Old Bard were still running shows during COVID, and they were outside and everything, and it was huge. Yeah, it just exploded. And then obviously Matt Cardona's brought like a huge big thing to it. That was one of the best moments. One of the best moments of that year was him beating Gage for that belt. But yeah, I think it's something different. A lot of people still hate it. It's garbage wrestling and all this stuff, but for the amount of like, GCW is probably one of the biggest independent companies in the world, and they wouldn't be anywhere if it wasn't for deathmatch wrestling. So there's certainly an audience for
Absolutely. I mean, I didn't watch Ring of Honor either, and I knew there was a big following of it, but they wanted to see just wrestling. Whereas, like I said, I'm a big silly character. I'm a WWE. WWE style is my kind of bread
yeah.
and butter style. So I knew, and it's weird nowadays where we do have that kind of, well, not even nowadays. It was still way back in during Monday Night Wars and all that. There was this all this tribalistic nature of wrestling, and I'm sitting there just going, "Yeah, I don't like it, so I'm not going to watch it. You watch it. I don't care. You go for it." I don't.
Is I you ever go on, the worst thing to do with your free time is to ever read Facebook, like AEW or WWE, like Facebook group posts, or if somebody puts up a picture of like Edge, all the comments, and you're just like, fucking hell, like, just don't watch it. Just be happy, like, go and do something with your days. The tribalism in wrestling's, I don't think I've ever seen that in any other sort of like sport or entertainment for things. It's mental for wrestling. Yeah, it's strange.
Mean, you get a little bit in football, I suppose. Again,
Oh
not
yeah.
something I'm in and about, but yeah, you see it like, oh, loyalty and all that passion, and you think, they're getting paid, they're safe, they're doing a job. It's like, I work in insurance, which is usually a a conversation killer. But it's like me going to another broker and just working there, and then people at my old job just going, "Oh, he wasn't loyal. How dare he?"
They've got your face up and thrown darts at because you've left to go and.
That's it. It's like, grow up, guys. Let's just watch it for, or someone going from EastEnders to Coronation Street. You know, it's who cares? Who gives a shit? Just watch the shows if you like them.
What was it? I read a comment today about Edge, and it was something along the lines of disgusting. He should have been in WWE for life. I was like, who are you to tell anyone else what to do with their free time or their money? Like, fuck off. But it's the same with deathmatch wrestling. There's tribalism, and if deathmatch Facebook groups are a strain. The deathmatch UK group, if anybody wants to join that, the guy that runs that, Sam's fucking great. I love Sam to death. But a lot of the American deathmatch groups, the amount of hatred that these deathmatches are like a niche of a niche of a niche.
Mm-hmm.
And loads of these people just hate each other. It's quite bizarre to see for like companies like XPW fans hate ICW and Old Bard and they hate them, but and you're like, fucking hell. Like there's maybe only about like 300 like proper hardcore fans, and they're all gonna go to all the shows anyway, so I just don't understand it.
It's the Willie Graveskeeper Willie meme, isn't it? Scotland ruined it for the Scottish ruined it for Scotland, all that kind of stuff. That's how it feels like. We're going, oh, we hate them, we hate them. Oh, we hate them as well. Oh, we just hate everyone. That's just how it ends up being. But I don't get it. It's yeah, Twitter is the same, or X, or called
yeah.
It.
I mean, I've got the only I hate social media. Like my Facebook and my Instagram is just wrestling. Mm-hmm. Like I've got my friends from school on it and stuff. But like, if I speak to like my actual like quote unquote the real life people that aren't in wrestling, I speak to them on WhatsApp. But everything else, all the other social media. X as well as just for wrestling, so
mm-hmm.
I kind of get consumed by it anytime I go on any social media because it's just wrestling constantly.
Yeah, that's it. And people replying going, oh, they should be doing this. And you're just like, well, they haven't. Move on, right? Okay, so right for someone who's watched wrestling for since what 98 for 25 years, I'm very jaded about wrestling itself.
Oh yeah, I hate wrestling. I said. I mean, I don't like. That's the thing. It's like I love wrestling. Like wrestling's like to me, aside from like my missus and my cat, is like the most important thing in like my life. But at the same time, I hate wrestling, and I hate a lot of aspects of wrestling. But yeah, it's one of these things that I want it to be for myself. Like I want it to be better, and I want everything to be. And it is. It's things are getting better from what they were like a couple of years ago. But yeah, there is like it's a lot of the fans that you're just like Jesus Christ, like just shut up.
I know, and you don't want to speak about it in actual face to face because at least on WhatsApp you can just close it and then that's it gone. But when you go, I say, oh, I went to the wrestling. Oh, I went to the wrestling. Oh, do you watch AEW? Oh, what are they doing with this? And I'm just sitting there, just going, oh, I wish I hadn't mentioned it because I don't
know
enough about this to go. Yeah, aye, age, cool, ace. Anyway. We like wrestling here. Sorry for anyone listening and thinks otherwise. I do enjoy wrestling. I just don't like speaking about it in real life.
Mm.
Catch me on Twitter. Right. Anyway, so you mentioned saying that you worked backstage on shows and did all that and kind of got a little bit of a... No, actually, let's talk about your first UK experience then. You talked about going to Atlanta to see Deathmatch Wrestling live. When did you find out TNT Rise? When did you actually find out you'd go, oh, I can just jump on a train and... We'll
fucking,
it.
I saw Big Joe. A shout out to Big Joe. Like, he is the face of British Deathmatch Wrestling, Big fucking Joe. The nicest man, the most hardest, like, hardest working man in Deathmatch Wrestling in the UK. I saw him on a tournament of death. He was against Casanova Valentine. And I was like, who's this? He's wearing, like, a shirt. He's just in his pants. He's got, like, a bouncer armband on. And they're like, he's from the UK. And I was like, who's Big Joe? Then I found out, and I was like, oh, my God. I was like, Rise is a company that's running in the UK and they're doing they did a deathmatch tournament. But this was, I think, before that, I think, or maybe slightly after that. But then I discovered it and I was like, there's wrestling in the UK that's got death. So I was like, right, fuck it. And then I'd start going to Rise shortly thereafter. But yeah, it was just, Rise was the sort of main one. Then TNT started doing death matches with DOA tournament and stuff. They even had... Jack Jester and stuff went down to DOA, and Jack Jester used to wrestle in Rise, early days Rise, in like 2014. But yeah, just from then I was like, holy shit, there's like a scene, as everybody likes to call it. There's a deathmatch scene in England, and now there's another company called Kumite who've been running for like 2 years And they're lovely guys as well. But yeah, just from Big Joe. Big Joe introduced me to UK Deathmatch Wrestling.
I think, I can't remember if it was a Deathmatch show, but I remember Jack Jester doing quite a lot of that kind of thing up here as well. This is just absolute tangent, but there was a show, I think it was some video game related thing where he ended up sitting down and playing SmackDown or something with his opponent. And then I don't know how it ended. I think it ended up with someone getting hit with a PlayStation, which broke my heart a little bit because PlayStation OG. But yeah, it was just one of those weird things. So you kind of get that surrealness with deathmatch wrestling, not only the blood and all that stuff, but you do sometimes just sit back and again seeing clips and you're watching it going, is that a flip-flop with drawing pins on it?
I'll grab something just now that I made for a show to sort of explain how ridiculous it was. I don't know if you're a fan. 2 seconds. Grab this. So I don't know if you're a fan of the Alien movies.
I know of them.
So I've got this, which is a full-sized face hugger. But if you can look on it, it's completely covered in thumbtacks. So I took this to a show down south. This is going to make him a debut in Scotland, I think, for our show. But yeah, stupid things like this is always quite fun. Yeah, but like you're saying, like flip-flops and cactuses and dildos. There's all sorts of like crap that people take to deathmatch shows and put barbed wire around them. Inflatable men. Pineapples covered in barbed wire and stuff like that. But yeah, it's ridiculous. But then the bloodshed and the violence and stuff is sort of the complete opposite to that. But you do kind of get like Big Joe's like wrestling in his pants, but then he's also completely covered head to toe in blood. So yeah, it's kind of ridiculous and violent at the same time.
That's it. It's like a duality. You can have a laugh and go, oh, he's took out that mask. Oh my God, there's blood everywhere. it's for you guys. Anyway, let's look at the show then. I feel like that I'm listening, I'm watching this or reacting to it like going, I don't understand, and I don't. But then again, my favorite bit of wrestling is, as I mentioned many times, but there was a match that I've watched recently where it was a guy in a mask and his big move was taking out an elongated tag rope so he could make a tag, and I loved that. That's my sort of shit. That was just hilarious.
Like the guy wrestling the tent.
I've heard about that. Yes, I have heard about that. Yeah, that kind of stuff.
He's like wrestling a tent, or the guy that's got the pizza.
Yes, that was what I was about to mention, the boy with the pizza. That's my kind of absurdity. That's all in for me. I can watch it going, oh my God, he's still got the pizza. Anyway, right, let's properly dive into Ultra Violence Referendum then. Saturday the 18th of November at the Dissection Room in Summerhall, Edinburgh. We've got loads on here, and they've got really nice name. Well, violent names. Yeah. That I'm going to ask about the rules of because I know nothing about them. So for anyone else who needs to know, Eventbrite, you can go find the tickets there. You can go to bleedinggums.co.uk. Doors open 5:30 for VIP, 6 p.m. general, bell time about 6:30 for general as well. All that out the way. So matches announced. So we'll start with folk that I've definitely heard of, and we'll move our way into the card. Mm-hmm. So we'll start with the matches that aren't advertised as death matches.
Okay.
Even though I know first one I go, I'm speaking about, I know at least one of the guys does like a bit of a scrap in a death match. Nathan Black versus Luke King Sharp. Big fan of Luke King Sharp at this end of the.
I think so. Nathan Black, if anybody doesn't know Nathan Black, is Nathan Black runs the PPW wrestling facility in Sheffield, and they've got some excellent guys. And he's also been in like Rise and things like that. If you've never seen a Nathan Black promo, you're in for a treat. He's an evil, dastardly, horrible prick, to put it in a better way. But I think that the match with him and Looking Sharp will be quite funny, mic-wise, because they can both cut excellent promos. Lou's excellent as well. Was just at Copenhagen last night. Looking Sharp, somebody that I wanted to get involved with, because he's somebody that I think would excel in ultra-violent deathmatch type stuff. This match won't be a deathmatch, but I think in the future, I think Lou's somebody that I think would be excellent and excel in deathmatch wrestling. And he gets to have a promo and a match with Nathan Black, who's somebody who's huge and is also a bit of a prick.
Luke King Sharp, of course, he did the Blood Tourist bit, and he was over in Scandinavia getting getting busted open and bleeding all over the place as well. So he's definitely got, yeah, he's definitely got the chops for it, as you're saying. And yeah, he's a guy that I anytime Looking Sharp's mentioned or put out there, that I love the guy. He's 5'4", but if you stand on his network connection book of little black book connections, he's about 6'7". So he's a guy that you want kind of on board, as well as first show. He's been around the block. A lot of the guys on the show are veterans, or at least have ran shows themselves as well. So at least you've got someone to ask advice of as well for your first event.
I mean, just even like a couple of weeks ago, me and sort of like a sort of promotion partnership between Bleeding Gums Wrestling and Copenhagen Championship Wrestling to promote each other's shows. Because like one of my mates and one of the guys on the show, Lou Nixon, he was one of the replacements last night. Lou's fucking excellent. He's a deathmatch wrestler. He's been over to America and everything as well. Lou's one of these people. But a lot of the guys that I've got, and you might notice it yourself, there's not that many Scottish people on the card, which people have said. But that's mainly because a lot of my connections are from down south. I've not really been involved in the Scottish wrestling scene like at all. So basically, the people that I've got are the people that I like and that I've seen so far. But I think as we've potentially more shows next year, there'll be a lot more Scottish talent as the more, because I was at, I think you were there, but I didn't get a chance to speak to you. I was at the last FCW show.
Yeah.
I was at the last FPWA show, and I'm potentially going to Discovery in Portobello, I think it is, the next one.
Yeah, Party in Porty, which is like 4th of November, I think it is. So
I think I'm good. Yeah. I'll be at that as well. So it's just more discovering people, because 95% of the guys are English, but it's just because that's all the sort of wrestling I've been around, being English wrestling. Yeah. Yeah, Looking Sharp, excellent.
I was about to say, is the Scottish scene, were you aware of it a lot? But it sounds like, no, it's more a case you were going to watch the thing. Like,
it's just been because there's not been any death matches up here. It's right. I'll happily go to FCW and things like that. Like, I'll go with my missus or whatever. But for me, and like for yourself, like, you've got kids. For me, I like over 18s, hardcore, extreme violence and bloodshed and stuff. ICW does have that as over 18s. But I think with ICW at the minute, like, aside from there being a bit of swearing and stuff, it's not like extreme, if you know what I mean. It's not deathmatch wrestling, really. So that's been down south, so that's where I've been.
Yeah, that all makes sense. But yeah, I was at FCW, and I was wandering around like a blue arse flea anyway, because I arrived later than I planned, and then I needed to try and get back.
Did you have trouble getting into the belt?
No, I got in easy enough, because they afforded me, I was allowed to go in a bit early so I could do interviews, but by the time I got there, everyone was planning matches, and I was like, I'm not really wanting to grab folk and go, oh, see this important thing that you're getting paid to do. Why don't you come away for it for 2 minutes so you can dick about with me? So I didn't end up getting one interview for that whole hour. I got in early, and then I was like, fuck, this has been Dundee. My shithole. Right, anyway.
Definitely.
It was a good show, though. Very good show from SCW. So I'm not saying that they were crap.
I think it was, this is just me, I think it was bookended by two great matches.
Absolutely.
Going to speak about probably the next match, I think you might mention, is Mr. fucking UNG Mackey against HD Drake. HD Drake, somebody's been wrestling down in England. He runs his own wrestling school. He is class. He's been over in TNT. He also does the ring for the show, is also HD Drake's. So we've got him. He does the Northern Grafter as his wrestling school, and he's wrestled everywhere in England. I think he might have been up in ICW.
I think he was. Yeah, I think he may have done that tournament as well. He's a name that I recognise from WCPW. When they ran as well. So he's a guy that I've, a recognizable name at the very least. I have heard of HD Drake in and about. So yeah, UNG Mackey is one of those guys that is one of those kind of polarizing figures because of stuff that happened in 2020. His name kind of got dragged a little bit through it. But he's still putting in hell of work in FCW, and his match against Zach Dynamite was brilliant.
It was great. But Ewan's one of these people. He lives in my hometown. I'm from Kirkcaldy. I've known Ewan from maybe 15 years, maybe more than that, and like from nights out and meeting him out in fucking kitties and society and things like that. Dated reference, probably, saying kitties because it just went on fire a couple of weeks ago. But Ewan's one of these people where I've seen him and his promos, and I'm like, yeah, he's fucking great. And I think that I think that he would excel in that, not necessarily in death matches, but I think he would excel in an over-18s environment. Mm-hmm. And I think if you give Yuen Jimaki the opportunity and the mic, that he could be a right horrible little bastard when he wants to be. I think yeah. So. I think that's the plan for having Yuen, and it's just to sort of give him something else, something to like bite his teeth into, and because he's an excellent wrestler, and he can, my Christ, can he talk as well?
He's very, very eloquent with his words, which clearly I'm not, because I stumbled over the word eloquent. But yeah, so that's the two normal, quote unquote, normal matches that we have lined up already. So let's just get into the name ones, because I've got questions. And I realize that we're coming up to an hour already. We're just
matches. Take all the time you want.
So we'll start with the bundled up and overboard death match with Iceman, who is a Scottish wrestling veteran. He used to come up here quite a lot.
I think he was WCL champion.
Yeah, he did wrestle his son in WCL very recently as well. I think it was May last year, I think it was. But anyway, Iceman versus Clint Margera, who, again, he's wrestled up here a couple times as well. So Iceman, Clint Margera, bundled up and overboard death match. What's that?
So just before we go into this, Iceman, Clint Margera, if you were going to make a Mount Rushmore of UK deathmatch wrestling, they are two people that would be on it without question. You couldn't really... Iceman's been bleeding since before a lot of the guys who are wrestling on this card were even like alive. Iceman's a legend. He had the best match I've ever seen live in my life this year in February, where his son nailed his ear to a ring. He got a wooden block out and nailed his ear to a ring with a hammer and nails. It was the best thing I've ever seen live, which might make me a bit fucked in the head. But anyway, this is for these two guys who have both been doing death matches for so long, they've never wrestled each other, which I find bizarre and shocking. If this is a first time ever match, they've never wrestled each other. Bundled up and overboard just because of the flag. It kind of looks like a pirate flag. Basically, it is light tube bundles, and there's going to be four boards in the ring, probably with things such as razor blades, knives, barbed wire, and things called gusset plates as well. So it's going to be boards and then bundles of light tubes that are duct taped up. That's the stipulation. I've just tried to be a bit creative with the names, because maybe not for yourself, but for somebody who watches death matches almost every day, I am so sick of just seeing light tubes every match. Yeah. Light tubes, light tubes, light tubes, light tubes, light tubes, light tubes, doors, 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 light tubes, light tubes, and there's no stipulations. I like a bit of stipulations because it splits up everything and it makes individual matches stand out. Whereas if you've just got five matches and they've all just got light tubes and it all just blurs together. But yeah, so that's the match. Light tube bundles and ultraviolet boards, pretty much.
Right. That's the first one that we're going through. I'm already feeling a bit, razor blades. Let's just, take a sec.
It's fun.
I'm sure it is. It does. It sounds fun for that kind of disposition.
Not for the family. Fun, but not for the family. That's what we'll say.
Go for that. All right. So we've got next up the, I'm going to butcher the word as well. To pay fists and thumbtacks, kick pads, death fight. Lou Nixon, who we've mentioned, and Dean Ford.
Dean Ford is a guy who I've been familiar with now from basically Lou is going to be on the show regardless. And the person that Lou was originally going to wrestle was double booked. And I said to Lou, who the fuck do you want to fight? Who do you want to fight? It's your decision. And he mentioned to me Dean Ford. So this is, without being vulgar, this is Dean Ford popping his deathmatch cherry, as it were, against Lou Nixon, who has got fucking boxing and MMA background and everything. And so does Dean Ford. Dean Ford's the prize fighter. So we're going to put glass all over their fists, broken glass on the tape, and they're going to have kick pads with thumbtacks on them. And it's going to be a death fight. So that's going to be that. So I think pretty much what I want to do with Lou Nixon and with Dean Ford as well is, just because they've got the MMA boxing background, is to make their matches fights, not matches,
right,
type thing. But it's a first time ever match, and it was at Lou Nixon's request, and Lou Nixon knows what he's talking about. So I was like, okay, fine. Dean Ford's first ever death match against Lou Nixon, Taipei fists and thumbtacks.
I have heard of Taipei. That was again, this is so nice.
No, that's all right, man.
But it makes for education for everyone. But I've heard of Taipei Fist. There was Axel Rotten, Ian Rotten. Did they do that kind of thing? Yeah.
The famous one. I think back then they would just use broken beer bottles, which is, I know this is trying to be sound, deathmatch wrestling isn't safe. But now you can get a little bit better with broken glass as opposed to using broken beer bottles, because that's slightly more dangerous and quite unhygienic as well for using broken beer bottles. But yeah, so it'll be good for Dean Ford as well, who's somebody who I've seen a lot more of now since he got mentioned to me by Lou. But he's all gung-ho for doing it. So yeah, because I think that's been a lot of what I've wanted to do, because obviously there's not a lot of Scottish guys on the show. But I want Scottish guys who are good enough and who want to do the ultraviolence stuff, that there is an actual place to do it, where they can be tested against the best in the UK and see if they're actually fit the mold type thing.
That's it. The wanting to do it is probably the most important thing, because if you want someone who's just there for a booking and you go, okay, you're doing a Taipei Fist thumbtacks kit pack, they go, oh no.
It's
not doing that.
It's a select mindset of people that enjoy the violence. Look at Looking Sharp, one of them as well, who like the bloodshed and like the violence and like the extreme stuff and everything. So I think there certainly will be people in Scottish wrestling who are good enough that maybe don't even know about the promotion or whatever. But eventually, as we move into next year and go forward, that there is a place for them to do it and be tested against people like Big Joe or Lou Nixon, who are the best, like who are traveled to America and everything. You know what I mean?
Yeah, absolutely. Next up, Death in a Box death match, triple threat. Tomby versus B.A. Rose versus Jack Bennett.
So Jack Bennett's a guy who wrestles in Lincoln. He's over in Japan next month to wrestle for a company called DIE, D-I-E, which is the best name you could offer a company. Japanese deathmatch, no ring company. Yep. B.A. Rose is a great wrestler who's wrestled Rise, TNT, and things like that. And Tomby is another guy who's been in Kumite and sticks tattoo needles in people's heads and stuff like that. So basically, what we're going to have is we're going to have boxes in each of the corners. And in each individual box, there's going to be mystery weapons, shall we say, of a sharp, pointy nature.
Right.
There are going to be four different boxes, and they're all going to have various different things. But like I've said, Tomby uses tattoo needles. Jack Bennett uses syringes. So there might be a chance of either of them being in any of the boxes, but we won't know that until the show.
So that's kind of like, I'm just making sure I've got the right reference, but from WCW, Booker T won the world title in something 49ers, whatever it was.
Oh, yeah.
My brain's going Glasgow. I thought, that's not right. It's definitely not that. But it's, yeah, that kind of idea.
I hung up on the thing. It was like a box and a pole and he wins the world title and it falls out the ring.
Aye, that's the one. So that kind of idea, but you know, the boxes will be a bit more solid and they'll have scarier things.
The boxes, they'll be like underneath the corner. So they'll basically like, it's just sort of mystery weapons, but that will be the way that the show is going to run. That will be the first death match of the evening, will be the Death in the Box death match.
Right, okay. So a nice little, for those that aren't sure and see that, they go, yeah, this is not for me. That's their point where they can go.
That's the thing is,
okay.
when you see that match, that'll be the first death match of the show. So we're going to pretty much do a couple of the non-death matches to start with, and then we're going to have a break. That'll be the first death match of the night. Okay. Yeah, that's pretty much going to be the testing waters for people who are there that have never seen it, to be like, yeah, this might not be for me. But for other people, they might think, holy fuck, this is great. But we'll never know until the night.
Absolutely. So we've also got the, I don't, is there any other interviews you've done for this so far that the person that's interviewing you has winced when you've been speaking about matches?
Not yet. I've done one with, I've done one with the guy from the Soul Sessions, did one with him, and he was the same. But like, I'm just trying to think, which match are you talking about next? I'm trying to think what would make you wince for it.
Oh no, man! Just in general, when you're talking about anything, right? But
it's like what you said. Like, you're in a bubble. I'm in a deathmatch bubble where 95% of the interactions I have with people in wrestling is all to do with deathmatches, and it's just kind of. But then you forget that when you actually meet, like when I was flying yesterday, you meet like quote unquote normal people. They're like, "What the fuck is that?" And you try and explain to them, and they're like, "No, no, no, oh, absolutely not." But some people have been quite perceptive to it.
Yeah, and the, but yeah, when you said I wonder what the next match is, yeah, that's actually kind of hits the wincing button. Grass is always bloodier on the other side. Alton Thorne and Jack Harrop, Jack being Iceman's son,
Yeah,
Iceman,
Iceman's son.
like is his surname, Iceman's son.
Yeah.
I saw cactuses. You've put on
Yeah,
your
it
social
was.
media of cactus, so I'm assuming that's the grass section of the thing.
Spoiler for that, we've got cactuses. Alton Thorne's weapon of choice is nettles. He brings nettles and puts nettles in the ring and puts people in people's mouths and stuff. Alton Thorne's another guy from Kumite. So we've got nettles. Alton Thorne's great, by the way. A big shout to Alton Thorne. He's one of the best in the country. I love Alton Thorne. We've got nettles, cactuses, terracotta pots, which is a new thing that we started using. We've also got weed whackers as well. So that's one of the matches that I think it'll be. There's also going to be various other different things as well. But that's one of the ones where, obviously, Jack's Iceman's son. He beat his dad at that match. I said it was like the best thing I've ever seen. But I think he's wanting to like go on his own and do his own thing, and sort of build his own legacy. And I think that same with Alton Thorne. And I think that will probably be one of the most sort of insane matches on the night. But yeah, but Jack's like job through the day is he's a landscape gardener as well. So he's got weed whackers and rakes and all sorts of shit. So yeah.
Right. Okay. That's actually the one that's brought a tear to my eye there, the nettles. It's the nettles. Out of everything you've went through, nettles was the one that's went, oh no, no,
I
that's the
remember
one.
when I first saw Alton Thorne, he was at TNT, it was a replacement, he wrestled Clint Margera, and he brought this big fucking black bag out, and I was like, what's in this bag? And he pulled out nettles, I was like, oh hell yeah, I was like, I've never seen that, like, for me, for watching, like, the same with Iceman's getting his ear nailed to the ring. For somebody that's watched death matches for like 20 odd years, I've never seen that. So if it's something I've never seen, I'm like, okay, that's pretty cool. But yeah, they both got sort of, and plus his name's Alton Thorne, they're both sort of very garden-centric people, I would say. So it's just a fancy way of saying it's a garden death match, really. But I wanted to give them big fancy names just to make them stand out.
Absolutely. So for as someone who's watched deathmatch wrestling for a long time, I'm not going to pull the curtain too far back here, but when you see something like a weed whacker getting thrown in there, do you, and you don't need to tell me, I'm happy never to know, but do you know how it's kept as safe as possible?
There's ways you can take the spinning. It's not a blade, it's like a sort of like plastic thing that they would
Oh
use.
yeah, aye. Okay, yeah.
Things you can take that off to make it, put something in replacement of that to make it more safe. However, some places don't do that, and you'll see people get hit with weed whackers and there's massive, massive scars all over them. It's more up to the guys.
Yeah.
It's the same sort of, with deathmatch wrestling, it's up to them. It's more like for a lot of these matches, a lot of the stuff's like been my idea, but obviously with asking them, because you would never ever expect anybody to do anything they didn't want to do. But like everybody's been happy with everything I've said so far. So yeah.
I feel like deathmatch wrestling has got the highest rate of consent. It's probably the highest level of consent you have to have, because wrestling itself is still, you've got to look after your opponents, but this is bringing in things that can go very wrong very quickly if
definitely.
It's not, if you're not confident in doing it, like a weed whacker. Like I remember it was Sick Nick Mondo that had his chest pretty much ripped open by a weed whacker, and
I'm against the white people. What a match.
So yeah, it must be just for again, outside looking in, when you're meeting all these normies that don't know about deathmatch wrestling, and they're looking at it going, oh my god, that's disgusting, it doesn't look safe. But you've got guys on the show that are veterans that know how to do it in an entertaining, safest possible way, even though it's still going to be absolute bastard for the next day.
Oh yeah, exactly. It's the same thing with, like, even if there isn't weapons, like even going back to a couple of weeks ago in AEW, John Moxley got dropped on his head, got a concussion. Like, injuries can happen whether there's weapons there or not. Obviously, there's a high chance of, like, obviously more blood and bleeding and stuff like that. But all the guys are trained professionals. I wouldn't have anybody do stuff that isn't trained and isn't like doesn't know what they're doing type thing. Yeah. Also, we've also got medics, so it's the safest possible way to do stuff like that, because I would never ever run a show without medics there, regardless if it's deathmatch or otherwise. Because worst thing that could possibly happen is somebody who's you're employing, who you're actually like friends with, and you know you're their boss, gets hurt in one of your shows, and you don't have anybody there. So yeah, we've got medics there, and even if people are getting hit with weed whackers, they're being hit with weed whackers in the safest possible way. If that's such a thing.
Oh, I love it. I am learning so much. Some of it may haunt my nightmares, but you know, I'm learning. Before we get to the main event then of the Holyrood hellscape, again, I'll have lots of questions about. We've got, as announced, but nobody announced for, we've got the fucking scramble match. And Darwin invades. I don't know if these are two things that are going to correlate.
They are separate things. I don't know if you've seen the promos that the good Dr. Leonardo Darwin did, where we had him in London dressed as William Wallace. Did you see any of that?
I've seen a couple of them, yeah.
So that was probably one of the most fun days I've ever had filming anything. So we've got, he's basically coming in to invade. He'll be doing a promo in the ring, and we'll see what happens from there. But the scramble match is going to be a straight match. It's just going to be basically a multi-man scramble. But it was more to do with GCW always have a scramble match. Every single show a scramble match. So I just thought I'd make it one better and call it a fucking scramble match. And I think as we're into October now, probably in the next couple of weeks, I'll probably announce some of the names for that match. But it'll be, well, the first announced name for it is Davey Blaze will be in the scramble match. And then there'll be other people get added as we go further in.
A little scoop for me, unless he told Soul Sessions and he gets out before I do. But a little scoop there. So that was kind of, that's pretty much what we've got going on. Then we've got the main event, which is the four-way Holyrood Hellscape death match with Big F and Joe, which you've put on the graphics as F and, you know, just keep PG, but it's Big fucking Joe, Danny Darko, Michael Caden, and Neil Diamond Cutter. Excellent name for that one. Hellscape death, I'm assuming this is just going to just be a balls to the wall, fucking everything involved.
Neil Diamond Cutter is a legend in deathmatch wrestling. He won Prince of the Death in 2009, and if anybody wants to look up him and John Moxley having a drunken deathmatch, just type in John Moxley drunk deathmatch, where he wrestles Neil Diamond Cutter, and John Moxley's wasted out of his face screaming Sweet Caroline. So that's Neil Diamond Cutter's theme song, Sweet Caroline, when he comes out to that. So Neil's been a friend of mine for about 10, 15 years, just speaking online. And he would be the first person. That match and this show is his UK debut. The first time he's ever been to the UK. So I've got him coming over from America. This year already, he's already been to Australia and Japan to do death matches. So we've got Neil making his UK debut. And the other three guys are collectively known as the Deathmatch Outlaws. Are three of the best and most sort of recognizable deathmatch guys in the UK. So yeah, the Hellscape, I might do some spoilers for that, but it's going to be mental. You've never seen anything like it in Scotland for the setups for what we're going to have for that match. But that's going to be, in a couple of weeks time, me and my mate are going to have wood and saws and drills, and we're going to be making some pretty fucked up stuff for that match. But yeah, I just called it Holyrood Hellscape because it's in Edinburgh.
Fair enough. That's right. Was there anything about Edinburgh in particular? Is just because you saw the name of the dissection room, which is perfect for what you're doing. Why Edinburgh?
Just for me, I think I didn't want to do Glasgow because obviously we've got ICW's like the over 18s company there. Hmm. I think Edinburgh's pretty much got Discovery. Discovery's a family show. Yeah, but never ever run purposely like at the same time as Discovery or ICW or any other sort of Scottish wrestling company as well, to be honest. Try and do something different. Mm-hmm. But Edinburgh was just because it's the capital. And I work there. I work in Edinburgh. Yeah, every day. And I work maybe, my work's 10 minutes walk away from Summer Hall. That was the 30th venue of 30 venues that I went into to try and get the show in. But a lot of them said, yeah. A lot of them were like, yeah, yeah. Because that's. I mean, obviously people running wrestling shows a bit different when you're like, yeah, by the way, people are going to be bleeding all over the floor. There's going to be glass everywhere. Like,
yeah.
A lot of people are kind of like, no, we're not going to have that in our venue. Fuck off. But A lot of places were like, yeah, it's fine, but the places were just far, far too small to fit like a 16 by 16 foot ring in. It wasn't like feasible. So the summer hall, they were like, yep, you can do it. The dissection room's pretty big. It's got a balcony. And the name just, I didn't even think about the name until afterwards. And I messaged somebody and they're like, that's a cool name for a deathmatch show in a dissection room. I was like, oh yeah, that is actually. But yeah, they just, Summer Hall were like, yep, you can do whatever you want as long as the place is clean after you're finished. And just a plug for the show, there's a full bar as well, so which is always nice.
I was just about to check, see what other shows are on that day, and very awkwardly, I have not put the show in my calendar. So I am gonna, by the time this episode comes out, it'll be on our event calendar.
Yeah, no. The
Forgot
thing
to put it
is,
there.
like, there's a lot of Scottish wrestling, and there's a lot of different wrestling companies in Scotland. Like from starting doing this, I've discovered that more. Obviously, there's like WrestleZone upside you. There's FCW. There's FPWA. There's W3L, ICW. There's a lot of Scottish wrestling, but that's what I think that this show and potentially further shows into next year is going to be something completely different from all of that. Because aside from ICW, everything else is family friendly, pretty much.
That's it. People, when this show was announced, and I was kind of umming and ahhing whether I was going to feature it because I don't know you. That's pretty much
Yeah,
most of
no,
my
thank
thing.
you.
But I spoke to Mark Leslie, who I know is a big
Out to
deathmatch
Mark.
guy, and I messaged him straight away and just went, right, this company, is it? Well, is the guy like legit? Is he or is he a
Yeah.
bit dodgy? He was just like, no,
No, you messaged me. No,
this guy's
that's
good.
perfectly fine, man. No, Mark Leslie, shout out to Mark Leslie. Mark will be helping out the show as well. Mark's one of these people that I just started speaking to online, and like I've made a lot of friends through just our love of deathmatch wrestling, and I'm good friends with Mark now. I message him like nearly every day. But yeah, Mark Leslie's ace, and he managed to get me maybe 500 light tubes that I've now got in my attic. So Mark's been helping out a lot with the show. Yeah, but
That's
no,
good.
it's fine because it's the sort of thing where a lot of the people, like say, like FPWA is like a relatively young company, but it's obviously run by Andy Roberts. Like all these people that run all these companies have been around for a long time, but nobody really knows who I am, which is fine because why would they?
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah.
But I'm always in the case where also talent you book because I try, like we mentioned Luke King Sharp, and I always love Luke King Sharp. I trust his judgment where he goes, I think, because
Yeah.
he's clued up enough to know to background check everything kind of
Yeah,
thing. So
definitely.
when I saw he was announced, I was like, I'm pretty safe with having you guys on anyway. But seeing Luke King Sharp pop up there, I was like, ah, it'll be fine. That's all good. That's all good. If you had like there's Ravy Davey as well, who obviously big on TikTok and stuff like that. He's the other guy where I kind of look at and go, right, is he working the show? Well, he's not going to jeopardize his brand working a show that's run
Yeah,
by
I know what you mean.
someone unruly. So it's just one of those wee things there. But I'm glad it's like you say, it's different. People have asked why or what my thoughts are, and my answer is mainly the same. It's not my style, but I know there's a niche for it. There's an audience for it, so people
Yeah.
will go. And it's not interrupting disco. It's not interrupting
Oh, no,
W3L by being
that's the
Ned
thing
DeBra
with
because it's not the same kind of product. It's wrestling, but it's not that wrestling. So it's
There's nothing like it in Scotland. It's not, I don't want to run purpose. I mean, obviously, there's going to be times when people book shows in advance and you end up running the same day as another company and things like that. But with a lot of the deathmatch fans, with a lot of the people that are already coming to this show, are the same people that go to all the Rise shows, go all the Kumite shows, go to all the TNT shows. So I would never ever purposely run against them either because it's just not good for business. Why would I want to run the same day as Rise when we essentially use a lot of the same people and a lot of the same fans go? It just doesn't make any sense.
Absolutely.
But you do get that in America sometimes where companies run purposely like head to head with each other, and you're like, why? Why are you doing that? Like, why not run the day after or run in the afternoon or something? Like, you surely want to get as much money as possible and give the fans the best experience. So I don't get that. I want to try and like there was a panic I did have in my head though when I booked it. Obviously, I booked this fucking what, July this year. I booked in the venue. In my head, I thought I was like, ICW are going to announce Fear and Loathing and the Sunday after my show. I was like, oh God, because I was like, if anybody's going to pick a show in Scotland, they would pick ICW because it's ICW.
Yeah.
And this is a completely new thing. They know what they're going to get type thing. But then they announced it for December. I was like, oh, thank God. Because usually they would run Fear and Loathing in November.
End of November-ish kind of thing, yeah. So
I was like, oh no, just because the way that they were sort of running their pay-per-views was like one every couple of months.
Yeah.
And I was like, right, they've done Shogs. I was like, oh, Christ. I was like, they're going to announce it the day after the show. I was like, oh, fuck. But then they announced it for December, so that was quite good.
Right. Well, we've run through the card and we've found out a bit more about yourself. So we'll do one final plug and for all the good stuff, and then we'll go and go about our day, and I can do my very little editing that I do. So for those that are interested, that have heard all that and want to find out more, they can go to bleedinggums.co.uk for all the information and all the links and forever social media. But for one final run through, Bleeding Gums Wrestling, the Ultra Violence Referendum, 18th of November 2023, taking place at the Dissection Room in Summerhall, Edinburgh. Running through the whole card, Nathan Black versus Luke King Sharp, Ewan G. Mackey versus HD Drake, a bundled up and overboard death match, Iceman versus Iceman. Why am I treating it like his surname? Iceman, because I've written it down as Iceman, versus Clint Margera, to paid fists and thumbtacks, kick pads, death fight. I said it right. Lou Nixon versus Death Dean, have it, and I said Death Ford. Lou Nixon versus Death Ford there. Death in a Box, death match, triple threat, Tumbe versus B.A. Rose versus Jack Bennett. I should have practiced all this beforehand. Grass is always bloodier on the other side. Death match, Alton Thorne versus Jack Harrop. We've got the fucking scramble match with two be-announced competitors. And a four-way Holyrood Hellscape death match. Big F and Joe versus Danny Darko versus Michael Caden and Neil Diamond Cutter. Doors open 5:30 VIP, 6 p.m. general. Bell time 6:30 for general admission. And tickets are available on Eventbrite. There we go.
Perfect. Thank you for that, man. Appreciate that. Yes. I hope to see a lot of the tickets are doing quite well. I think that we're definitely, I don't think we'll get a sellout for the first show, but there's always room to grow. But I think it's definitely doing a lot better than I expected. A lot of the flyering and stuff's been helping massively. But yeah, get your tickets. I'll guarantee there won't be anything like it in Scotland. Absolutely not. There won't be. It's exactly like you said. It's going to be different. And it's going to be something that we've not had in Scotland. Which is quite handy, and I'm very, 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 very proud of deathmatch wrestling, and I defend it to the bitter end. So yeah, I'm very, very happy to be doing this, and hopefully all the fans do as well.
Wonderful. Well, thank you very much for taking the time to speak to me today, and good luck to the show. And I'm looking forward to finding out the results and seeing some pictures and cringing at some videos. Going, oh my god, no, it's definitely not for me. But the crowd reaction, I'm sure, will outweigh my wincing. But no, love it. Thank you very much.
No worries, man. Appreciate it. Thank you very much. Cheers.